Well, just so we can understand your business model a little better, how exactly do you earn revenue?
We provide, through a security guard firm, we provide security guard services to communities and corporations.
Okay.
So an example is, when I first started, I was just in neighborhoods in the east side of Detroit, a place the police and citizens called Crack Alley. Basically, it was 10 apartment buildings, 400 dwellings, maybe 100 aggressors. So one quarter of the population was, you know, violence-oriented gang members. The rest were just families and senior citizens. Hundreds of people needed help. And I couldn't get the police to help them, so I got volunteers. I talked to the business owners, and I said, listen, give me a free apartment in your building, and I'll train a person to protect your building, and we'll get rid of these home invasions and these murders. And this was every month. Every day there was a home invasion, and every month, this is one square block, okay? And every month, there were murders. And so what happened was, from the day I started, there was only one more home invasion. I caught them, and there were no more murders from the day I started. So the building owner suddenly went into the black for the first time in 20 years because no one moved from the buildings and everyone paid their rent.
Ah.
As a result of people paying their rent, because there's no murders, rapes, and killings, all of a sudden the corner store, the liquor store, the laundromat, all those places started to flourish because they had more customers.
This is so smart. This is so smart. Now, what's been your biggest challenge?
Well, the challenges have evolved as we evolve. So at first it was police officers interfering in protecting the family, literally interfering. So they'd see us with our rifles outside of buildings where I started. We were very gun intensive. So not only would I have guns, I would have the best guns, like anything that was 30 caliber or higher, 7.62, and with lots of rounds. This was, I thought, was the best approach, because I was a soldier, I was a martial artist all my life. So for me, it was, you know, I'm going to use superior violence of action to change human behavior. And to a certain degree, it works. What I found out would work better was cameras. Believe it or not, violent criminals hate video cameras because it takes away anonymity and proves that they're the ones doing something. And they know that. That actually worked way better than a 30-round magazine or a 50-round magazine or drum. And so I slowly changed out over many years from guns to cameras. They just were a lot more effective. A broke camera was more effective at getting rid of drug dealing gangs than actual guns.
Huh.
Imagine that. In my mindset, that wasn't even a possibility. So instead of me using my force of violence and superior violence concept, imagine if I went to a group of drug dealers, you know, it's about 15 of them, sunbathing outside of a farm building full of families who are terrified. And I said, gentlemen, listen, so I'll let you know the police, they're taking our footage and they are analyzing it. They're looking for criminals who are wanted. And I just want to let you guys know, you know, I'm not saying you guys are drug dealers or anything like that. I'm just letting you know they're taking our footage and they're, you know, looking for people with warrants and they're, you know, taking it from us. So the thug looks at me and says, oh, this is the gang leader. He's like, man, thank you. Good looking out. And so they go in the building, right, and hide from our cameras, and they're not our enemy because they believe I'm giving them information that helps them. Want the truth? The police couldn't care less about our footage. And by the way, I was so poor at the time, the cameras that I had were broken. We were just pointing broken cameras from top of
buildings. Oh, my gosh.
We had no money. So I had some broken video cameras. I had some volunteers from a high school that scared the drug dealers away. Now, what does that mean? That means when a nurse came home with her child, that means when elderly people got off the bus, these were poor people primarily, that meant that they didn't feel terror. That meant they weren't going to get spit on by thugs who were upset because the mother wouldn't give out their phone number. That meant no tyranny for the children who came to these low-income homes and were paying a very, very high wage amount of money for their apartments and getting nothing in return from the building owners who were not interested in public safety, would not give them a better lighting, better doors, better locks, which I did suggest. Another example is I put a piece of paper on the walls entering the building. So imagine inner city, you know, buildings that you have gangs in them in the hallways and drug gangs running rampant. And I put these signs up and I laminated them to the door. And I know people said that, you know, basically gang members can't read. Apparently they read very well. I typed this document up, put it on the wall, made it look official, and it said, notice to all police, you must call this number because there are undercover armed security posing as drug dealers in these buildings. And I put my cell phone number up there. The truth is, police aren't going to leave anything on the wall, and they're definitely not going to call us for any reason, so they didn't. But the drug dealers stopped trusting each other. They were terrified of each other. They thought each one of them was actually one of us. And the truth is, I had no undercovers. I had no one with guns running around undercover. That was just a lie. That lie caused them to not get along, to not want to be in the hallways, to not talk to each other, which once again meant a higher quality of life, safer for the families that live in the buildings, which are hundreds of families with little children, older people, senior citizens living in terror, now have a quieter life because there's less drug dealers and thugs. These are drug thugs. These aren't like drug dealers that are dealing drugs to another adult. These are actual guys who are dealing drugs just so they can get more bullets, more guns, and more ability to hurt people. And so there's a difference. There are real drug dealers. These were not them. These were like thug dealers and gangs of them. But we made them psychologically not want to be there. We created an aversion, and they took hold of it and stopped wanting to be around there. Then the final one I'm going to tell you, I have a video that shows us pull up broad daylight. I get out of a car. It's just getting dusk, and there's eight drug dealers on a corner, just like in the movies. And one big, really big guy with a big afro, 6'8", looks like a lineman from a football team. And the other guy has long hair, looks like a pimp. They step forward from the group of eight drug dealers. Two of them step forward. When I said to them, you got to clear the area on a PA system, and I'm in an unmarked van, and I'm in uniform, but I said, you know, there's a spotlight, but it's just getting dusk. And this is on a major street in Detroit, very close to where our mayor lives. And these two drug dealers get off the curb, and they yell, we're not moving, we're not leaving. And so I approach them, and you can see it on video. And as we approach, the one guy kind of reaches forward towards me. So you hear me, you can see me on film, take a baton, smash it across his shin, and you hear like a breaking noise, cracking noise. He stutters, lifts me off the ground. I choke him down, and I choke him into this van, and I take him away, as well as another staff member takes the other guy away. So these two men are seen being choked away, screaming, gurgling, and they're never seen again. The other drug dealers that are on the corner never come back to that corner ever again. That corner had had drug dealers up until 1995, since the 60s. Okay? So this is the first time it's been clear. If you go there today, and I have not been there active in over 15 years, there's still no drug dealers there right now. 20 years later, there's no drug dealers in this corner. And what's interesting is the building owners, some of which flew in from Florida, very wealthy people, came in to terminate me because they heard that I had choked these drug dealers out and disappeared them. There was actually an investigation launched, I learned later. They called us the body snatchers because we snatched these guys off the street and no one ever saw them again. And I showed them the video, and they were mortified. These very wealthy men were mortified, not terrified for some reason. I don't know why they weren't terrified. If they thought I abducted drug dealers, the first thing I would think if I were them was, I don't want to get abducted too.
Yeah, but I don't want to deal with this guy.
Right, but I want to be real happy if I get out of here and get my lawyer and fire this guy, right? But no, they fired me immediately. They were like, you know what? You're disappearing drug dealers. We're going to terminate you right now. And I said, why are you going to terminate me? He goes, because you can't do that. I said, yeah, I can. Everything I did was legal. And they were like, how is it possible for you to legally abduct people on the city streets and drag them away? I said, I didn't abduct anyone. I didn't hit anyone. And I didn't take anyone away against their will. They were like, what do you mean? The two men that we struck, the two men that I choked, the two men that we dragged away, these men essentially are my students, a part of my academy. They were acting like drug dealers. And for 4 hours prior to this, we were driving up to them, giving them money, no drugs, just giving them money. So the other drug dealers really thought they were real drug dealers. So it looked real to the actual drug dealers that these two guys, they were smart enough, they realized the reason why one of the guys is 6'8 with a big afro and looks like a football player because he is a Wayne State University football player.
Oh, wow.
That joined our organization. The other guy is actually a post office worker, and he's posing as this drug dealer. and we beat them with rubber sticks. There's no actual, metal or anything. They weren't hurt. And the next day they got haircuts because we have a very strict dress code. The next day they were in uniform with haircuts, so nobody recognized them.
That is unbelievable.
And the drug dealer stayed away. The kid, there was no violence. There was no court dates. And we cleaned up the area using psychology, not physicality. That's the moral of the story. Nonviolence works. You just have to outthink the violent criminal, and it changes their behavior, and we can create a nonviolent outcome just by having strategies to inspire people, not intimidate them, inspire them to think differently.